coming to you live from Radio Cayman Studio.
For the record.
For the record.
For the record.
Hear from your government officials, independents, and the opposition on issues that matter to you.
For the record.
Engage in an open dialogue between residents and lawmakers.
For the record.
For the record.
Informative, impartial, insightful.
This is your talk show.
1-800-534-8255. Your calls, your input. This is For the Record. And now, your host, Oren.
Good morning and welcome to For the Record right here in the beautiful Cayman Islands. Today is August 14th, 2015. Another beautiful day in paradise, if you have woken up to it. And of course, if you didn't wake up to it, then you really don't know about it. Of course, For the Record is a show produced by the staff and management of Radio Cayman, geared towards keeping you abreast of issues as they arise and play out on a local, regional, and international scene. I have had the pleasure over a year now of being your host. My name is Orit Connor, and you are faithful, loyal listening audience are welcome to join us every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday from 7:30 a.m. until 9:30 a.m. Our phone lines are always open. There is always someone waiting to take your calls, normally in the form of Miss Susan Watson. You can call us on our toll-free number, which is 1-800-534-8255. You can also call us on 949-8037 or 949-6990. And of course, if you don't like to talk on the telephone, you can email us at For the Record. That is one word, For the Record, at CANDW.KY. We're going to take... Before I go there without talking about our sponsors, otherwise we may just be off the air. And of course, we are glad to have on board our sponsor every day that For the Record is broadcast. And that sponsor is Digicel Top Up. At Digicel Top Up, you can send minutes to your loved ones in Jamaica from a Digicel retail location or Top Up kiosk. And when you do that, they will receive double credit plus 7 free days of data when you send $20 or more. Good deal, great deal from Digicel Top Up. Before I introduce my guests this morning, we want to go over some of the significant things that are happening today. Internationally, huge day for Cubans and the United States of America. U.S. Secretary of State John Kerry, I think as I speak, he's on his way to Havana, where he will officially open the U.S. Embassy over there. The flag will be raised at the U.S. Embassy. What is significant about that was that 1961, I believe, the three Marines who actually lowered the flag at the U.S. Embassy in Havana when the United States broke off diplomatic relations with Cuba, those Marines who actually lowered the flag there will be there to hand the flag to the current Marines who are there for them to hoist it as well. So that is extremely significant. Big deal for the United States. Big deal for the Caribbean. The United States have realized that they're going to be really fall behind in the game when it comes to Cuba. The Europeans already have sort of a foothold in there. The Canadians definitely have a foothold in there as well. U.S. realize that they're losing a golden opportunity to get in on the ground floor, as so to speak, in relation to Cuba. So they're going to have a little catching up. I think despite the Republican opposition to it, U.S. businesses are looking forward to the vast, vast opportunities that will be available in Cuba. Of course, to really get the Cuban economy going and to benefit the Cuban population, it is also important for them to be able to earn a decent wage, to be able to stimulate the economy as well. So while there are opportunities, there will be huge challenges as well. So with my little spiel on the international scene, I want to introduce our guest this morning. We have one usual suspect, Mr. Christopher Saunders. And this morning, we also have the pleasure of having in the studio with us Mr. Kenneth Bryan, who came in on short notice. Got a text message from Mr. MacPhail this morning, and he didn't realize that he actually had a doctor's appointment this morning. And he sent me a text message while I was on my way in to work. And just for all of those of you who thought that I read or may think that I read my text message while I was driving, no, I waited until I got in the parking lot here, and then I saw it. And then, of course, I gave Mr. Kenneth Bryan a call because yesterday evening he said to me, you know, if there was a spot on there to let him know. So on really, really short notice, he was able to get in here. Of course, I had to use my networking, so I had to go to the political field coordinator, Mr. Moose Edlin Moore. I got on to him, he said, don't worry, I'll get on to Kenneth, because I tried calling Kenneth on WhatsApp, but he explained to me why he didn't get the call through WhatsApp. So the political field coordinator, I guess we'll have to call him a telephone coordinator, as well, he was able to get on to. So, gentlemen, Mr. Christopher, Mr. Kenneth, good morning. Welcome back to For the Record on your Friday morning.
Morning, OC. I noticed they called him a Christopher this morning. Every other Friday is Christmas, but you pwned me last night. So all of a sudden, you get very formal now. But, Kenneth?
Newfound respect for you because you got broad shoulders after 3-6 loves.
Listen to me. My mistake was I went and sit down with Ricky. Ricky had just gotten a 6 love. And I said, you know what? This man's a little bit too wounded. Maybe I can redeem him, and boy, it was a massacre afterwards. But
Chris, are you suggesting to the Cayman Islands public that you got 3-6 loves last night?
Listen, they're free, you know. We don't charge for them. But I it's good to be here. I'm glad I came in. I saw Kenneth. I've always liked listening to Kenneth. I know he's a person who's passionate about the Cayman Islands and many of the issues, especially the mortgage issues. I just want to say a quick congratulations today. Many people who got real good news in terms of their CXC results that's been rolling out. I know Darlene Manzanares, our daughter Yelani, who's actually summer interning with us over at my workplace. So congrats to her. Also, Andrew and Alicia Copeland, their daughters, Aaliyah and Angelique, I understand they did very well also in terms of their CXC. And I just want to ask the people to say a little prayer for Manny. Manny has been diagnosed with cancer and everything else, and from what I understand, that even the support of the current government has been quite good in terms of helping him. Everyone knows Manny, but one of the things OC, and I mean, I just recently got the news, but I will say this much: the whole cancer issue in Cayman, something seriously needs to be looked in it. I mean, For some of the cancers that we're having in this country, I mean, for a small island, I mean, clearly we need to be looking at something. There's no way people can be getting, this far unless something is really fundamentally wrong. And this is something that needs to be looked into. This is not a political issue. This is a personal issue for everyone. And that is something that I'm hoping that as a people that maybe one day we can find a solution. But I don't know if it's in the food that we're importing or what it is, but clearly there's something amiss that needs to be tackled. And you know, Kenneth, so it's good, like I said, to be sitting here. Miss Steve and Steve appointment this morning is something that's positive and a part of his road to recovery.
Yes, and I did point that out to him. Kenneth, good morning.
Good morning, OC. Good morning, Chris. It's a pleasure to be here. Good morning to the listening public. Obviously I'm excited to be here anytime I have a chance to speak publicly to my people, as well as have open dialogue with very intelligent persons like the two men I'm in this room with today. It's always a great opportunity, and there's so many irrelevant issues that are going on in this country right now in respect to the people that can be discussed, and I'm just glad to have the opportunity to be one of the minds that can contribute to that discussion. So thanks again for having me, and I think we're going to have a lovely show this morning.
Okay, and Chris Graham says, not even Graham, right? Not even the Graham. Rankin gets 3-6 allows back to back. Well, of course, you know why? Because he never sticks around after he gets the first one.
Listen.
Or he goes and sits down in his lounge chair.
Well, that's what he did last night, because, I mean, when I came in, I mean, there's Ricky as a visitor coming in. He was just, you know, picking up something with Aha. And normally, the right thing is not to play somebody who just got beaten up. I mean, that's normal. But the person's a guest, we're playing for funny, and it's free, it's all free. So, you know, my mother said every day is like that, or nights like that. So, that's all right. Next week could be a better week for me.
And of course, Dale brought poor Ricky along to take so many head blows there.
I thought they were friends.
You know? Yeah, he brought him in, walked him right into that.
And
but he's a good, Ricky's a good
sport. And then you, my own partner, to give me love with, but that's fine.
Yeah, Rick is a good sport. Gentlemen, let's talk about the local scene. Talk about crime, because that is on everybody's minds these days. We saw burglaries on Victory. Was it Victory Avenue, Victory Lane, in the Prospect area? We saw in West Bay where the police made an arrest on the road when they, you know, saw a suspicious person, stopped them, searched them, found jewelry and everything else. We see burglaries being conducted at business locations and everything. Police are doing as much, I believe, as they can, because they can't be, you know, everywhere at once. We know, for instance, we've heard now, and I think there's mounting evidence to support the fact that a lot of the burglaries, when it comes to boat engines, when it comes to gardening equipment, construction equipment, a lot of it is being sent overseas to be traded for drugs to be brought back to the Cayman Islands. So that may be why a lot of items are not recovered. We hear the stories about the fact that the Jamaican dealers, they like the two-stroke engines or something like that. So, and that when they steal, when outboard motors are stolen, they usually like the 75 to 85 horsepower type, because that's exactly what. So we want to say to those people out there, if you have, you know, items like that, keep them secure, because the people are stealing them. There are opportunistic burglaries that are taking place. They're targeted for certain items because they want to take them and trade them for drugs, including cell phones. So it's not unusual these days when you see robberies taking place, they want to take your cell phone as well, because again, they're using that to trade for drugs. Any comments, gentlemen?
Yeah, one of the things also, OC, and a friend of mine, I mean, he was just burgled this week, Patrick Barnes. And in that case, it was actually more, from what I understand, younger people, students out of school. And it's imperative that we do find work for a lot of our young people. I mean, the thing about it, it is sad, because it is also a little bit sign of the times, in the sense of where people still need to feed their families. And I'm not justifying crime, but we as a society, I mean, again, this is not a political issue. This is an issue that we all as a society have to deal with. And unless we create opportunities for our people, and realistic opportunities where they can make something of themselves. And studies have shown, I mean, we look at when, I think the previous government had their Christmas cleanup, where they're literally paying people to clean up, the crime rate significantly dropped. You look at when we had like even major, like even football events going on, where a lot of people just had something to do, crime again went down. So it is, it's a combination of many different things, but at the end of the day, we as a society need to ensure that we never become desensitized to crime. I mean, yesteryear has gone by. I remember growing up, when a burglar went down or something, it was like big news throughout the community. Now we have become so accustomed to it, we're kind of like, you know, you had Buster a couple of weeks, well, just recently again, being robbed again. I mean, this is something that needs to be tackled. And again, this is something that we as a people need to get together and see exactly what the root crime is. We also do know some of the people who are involved in this kind of stuff. And we need, I guess, tougher policing and some tougher laws to lock some of them up. I mean, put them away.
Okay, when we come back, we're going to ask Mr. Brian to comment as well. We know he has his feet on the ground and his ears close to the ground as well. Folks, I want to remind you that you're listening to For the Record. I'm your host, Art Connor. My guest in the studio with me this morning, Mr. Christopher Saunders, Mr. Kenneth Bryan. Please stay tuned. We'll be back shortly, and we will also take that caller that we have online. Good morning and welcome back to For the Record. Kenneth, we're going to take this phone call first and then we'll get you to comment on a local crime situation. A caller, good morning. Welcome to For the Record.
Thank you for taking my call. Good morning, gentlemen.
Morning, Mr. Brown. How are you?
Morning, Mr. Brown.
Fine, a sifted flower. How want to do it?
Great, great, great.
Good.
Getting any rain over that side in Brat?
Rain? Well, it must have been kind of a heavy dew last night because looking at the leaves on the trees and they kind of look saturated to me, so heavy dew, yes.
Okay.
How was the sojourn? Go ahead, Mr. Connor.
No, I was going to say, even that helps. I believe there was some indication that Jamaica was getting some rain yesterday, so hopefully it's coming in our direction.
Yeah.
Hopefully.
We need it.
We certainly do. Mr. Bryan, how was the sojourn to England? Tell me about it now.
It was, well, you know, I appreciate you asking the question. It was a great time to get away. You know, I myself, my wife, and my two kids, I went down to the south side, you know, had a chance to be in the country outside of London for a while. And, you know, it gave me a good breather, so to speak, you know, flush out my brain, get things off my head, think about who I am as a person, what am I doing with myself, what are my ultimate goals, and re-energize and re-strengthen mentally and physically, because my hopes and aspirations are not one to take lightly, and you have to be prepared in all capacities, especially mentally. So it was a good break, Quincy.
I'm happy to hear that, and
Thank you.
Sure your fans, your followers, those listening, they're happy to hear that report as well. And what I would like, if possible, even though I know the trial is ongoing and continues, without giving away too much, if we could, if the moderator would allow you to, hear your side, because the prosecution, they're going to get their side out there. We want to know what really happened, because I think, like, there's some sort of... and look here, Facebook, social media, it's on fire this morning with comments about what's going on. And I think that there's an evil system in place. Yeah, they talk about not fear. What's going on? This shouldn't be. All I had to say was this. Mandela was in prison for 27 years. That should not have been, but it is what it is. There's an evil system out to target our people. Either they want to imprison us or lock us away in mental institutions. So guess what, Mr. Bryan? Neither of the two is going to happen to you, because you have a bright future. And you have a praying mother who prays for you, and you have a great support in this community. And your followers, your fans, your supporters need to rally behind you at this time. And on the day of sentencing in November, if that's when it is, they need to surround that courthouse. And if the verdict is not to our liking, may we uprise. It's time for the people to come together, you see? Because I believe that you were targeted, as I was 2 years ago. The judge gave me community service. My story was slightly different, but what I'm going to be doing in Kamana Bay tomorrow with my comedy show is the same thing I was doing on Kim and Brack. A hungry artist who looking little money. I can put a cantina down on the ground and perform.
Starving artist, huh?
Well, looking at me, you would not think that I'm starving. So look at me now. You mean to tell me I can't put down a box or a cantina with it marked singing for tips, performing for tips, and I didn't put no money in it, you know. But if you think I have the talent, as you walk by, can you not put a dollar or two in it so you can put me in court for that? No, no. I've gotten permission from Kamana Bay. So at Abacus High Tide, the great-sounding musical group, they will be there, I will be there doing comedy, and I will be soliciting some tips, not begging, but it's your chance if you like my performance.
Is that tomorrow, Quincy?
That's tomorrow.
Well, I tell you what, I think I may just make an evening of that, because any of your comedy is definitely highlighting and very humorous. So I think I might just come down, and I would inspire everybody else to come down as well. But if I had the opportunity to answer your question, Quincy, I unfortunately I'm not going to be able to discuss my side of the story, because it is still before the judge, a very capable one, I believe, as well, who's is going to be able to handle this case appropriately and fairly. That being said, though, I will have my opportunity before the Honorable Judge to say my side, and I hope that a lot of people do come, because it's important for them to know the truth about what happened. And I have some major concerns about what exactly happened myself, Quincy, and a lot of things are being revealed. So I would implore you to come, you know, keep your head up with the news. A lot of people are covering my story in relation to what happened with me. But I'll say this. Some people say there might be a conspiracy. I believe the good Lord knows what he's doing. This testament that I'm going through is truly a testament for me to see. When I asked him to help assist me to be a leader for my people, I believe he allowed this to happen, to test me to see if I have the strength to be a leader. 2017 is coming around the corner, and I think this is a way for him to say, okay, Mr. Brian, you say you want to be a leader, I'm going to give you a test. Let's see how you handle yourself throughout this. He took me away from a situation I didn't want to be in anymore. He's given me the strength I need. So there's a reason for everything, and I'm not trying to draw this out, but I trust in the Lord, and I know that he will guide me perfectly. He's guided me this far, and I would just say, keep your ears open. Focus on the media who's covering the stories. They've been very fair to me so far, so I'll say that, and hopefully I have my side in November, Quincy.
And you're popular, absolutely, and your popularity is growing, and that's a good thing as we approach 2017. Mr. Connor, let me end by saying, sir, because you know I am an impersonator and comedian, talk about conspiracy, Mr. Connor, in the words of the governor, no, not at all. It's not a conspiracy at all. In the words of Auditor General, no, not at all. I think I'm actually going to hang my hat up. I'm going to hang my hat and go to Scotland one more time before heading off to Paris. And with your permission, Mr. Brian, I will also be impersonating you, okay, even though this is an ongoing case. Listen, I am Madam Speaker, I rise as the longest serving member in that they tried to remove me as the country's first premier. I'll see you on Saturday. I just want to wish you the best, Mr. Brian. Your people are behind you, and you are the successful brother. There was Cain and Abel, and there's also the story of the prodigal son. We love and support you, Kenneth Brian.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Quincy. Thanks for that.
Quincy, have a good one, and good luck tomorrow.
So, Kenneth, the local, you know, crime scene on for the record on Wednesday, I was pretty used strong words, strong language, especially to the bleeding heart liberals, to say when I talked about the uneven playing field,
yeah,
in relation to the criminals and law-abiding citizens, where the criminals, you know, have the upper hand. They're allowed to have illegal guns. Yeah. Not that they're allowed to, but they have them.
Yeah.
And then law-abiding citizens don't have the ability to have them. Some do, but very, very, very small numbers. And what I basically said was, yes, we can blame some of this on unemployment, but a lot of it are people out there, opportunists, who are looking, who, whether or not they got a job, wouldn't matter. Mm-hmm. They're going to still go out there and seek to victimize people because they want things and they want to get them the easy way.
Easy way, right? Yeah.
We only have about four minutes, and I think we have a couple of callers, but we'll probably take the callers after the news.
Well, I'll try to be concise as I possibly can. Okay. OC, you are correct in saying that, you know, there are still people out there. You can't blame everything on unemployment, and that some people would just want to be lazy and do the wrong thing to make a quick dollar. But I do believe that percentage is a very small one. In respect to, that's why before the unemployment problem came in, we had smaller numbers of crime. So I do contribute majority of the crime that we're facing today to unemployment. I mean, that's the feeling that I'm getting. I mean, unfortunately, I know many people who find themselves in positions where they might end up doing something silly. I've talked to young men, and they go, you know, I hope you're focusing your life. He said, yes, Mr. Brian, we're doing well. And then 2 weeks later, I found out that he robbed the store or something, and then I have to go sit down and talk with the mother and saying what's happening, and then you find out that he's in court and all that. So I do believe that unemployment is a major factor, because it's so many of them who've tried to ask or asked me to try to get them a job. Unfortunately, because of the current circumstances with the unemployment, I can't get everybody a job. It's very difficult right now to get Caymanians a job, unfortunately. So they try to find a way to survive. Now, the biggest problem is when we speak about unemployment is that people say, well, okay, then we can't just give them jobs. But in all honesty, now that the more I think about it, it'd probably be more cost effective for us to just pay them not to be in trouble, because the costs that are associated with criminals today, from the police, the prison, the courts, the lawyers, and the economic damage that it's doing to us, our country as a whole, we cannot quantify it. I mean, we're talking about a population of 50,000 people. And we could be talking about a group of 200 people who are terrorizing our reputation globally. And I think the representatives are not looking at the social elements. The current representatives who are in charge of this country is not looking at the social elements are going on. Because if they put more of a focus on identifying those who are vulnerable to do such things and try to assist them, that we can bring down those levels, bring down the cost of what I just highlighted from the prison, the courthouse, the police officers, and it would be more cost effective in the long run. It's a kind of hard theory to detail out right here on the radio in such short notice, but I think it's better off that we try to get them employed from a cost perspective for the country.
Let's see if we can, Ms. Susan, if we can grab the caller before we go to the... They're going to call back. Okay. They're going to call back at this point in time. We have about a minute left to go before the headline news. You want to come straight to you now, Ms. Susan. Folks, I want to remind you that you're listening to For the Record. I am your host, Art Connor. My guests in the studio with me this morning, we have Mr. Christopher Saunders, Mr. Kenneth Bryan, two former candidates in the 2013 general elections. I also want to remind you that For the Record is sponsored by Digicel Top Up. You can send minutes to your loved ones in Jamaica from a Digicel retail location or Top Up kiosk, and they will receive double credits plus 7 free days of data when you send $20 or more. So, Moose, you hear that? You can send $20 or more. Please stay tuned. We'll be back shortly. Good morning and welcome back to For the Record, and I hope you all are still with us out there. Kind of long for the news, but we trust that you haven't changed the dial. Welcome to For the Record, where I'm your host, Orit Connor, and in the studio with me this morning, we have two young political aspirants in the Cayman Islands. Two young men who were candidates in the 2013 general election, Mr. Christopher Saunders and Mr. Kenneth Bryan. We were talking about the crime situation in the Cayman Islands, getting a real local perspective on it, and one from ground level as well, where both of these gentlemen have their feet and their heads to the ground, so they get lots of information in terms of what's happening out there. We don't have anyone in lines now, Ms. Susan. Let's look at another story here. And first of all, I want to say that I am really not in the conspiracy theory business. I don't believe in that. But this one has me thinking, and I'm going to read as much of it as I possibly can. On Tuesday, the 11th of August, the Financial Crimes Unit, FCU, was informed by a local branch of an international bank that four men and one woman had come to their offices to discuss potential business of $500 million in foreign exchange transactions. Bank officials were suspicious, asked the group to leave, and alerted the Financial Crimes Unit. That day, Financial Crimes Unit promptly alerted all banks of the suspicious activity, arrested one suspect on suspicion of money laundering while he visited another bank, and arrested another two members of the group later in the day at their hotel, where their rooms were searched.
The last two members of the group were questioned after intelligence research revealed information about their current location. The group consisted of four men and one woman, three UK citizens, and two US citizens. Okay? All members of the group were released yesterday and have now left the country as evidence was not sufficient to sustain eventual charges. However, authorities in the UK and the US have been alerted to their activities while here. Now, we know that the US and the UK, when it came to the Iraq war, that they were hand in hand with that. The US got support. We know now the real reasons why the US went to war in Iraq. It had nothing to do with weapons of mass destruction, but to get at Iraq's oil. It was all for commercial purposes. So we know when Americans and Brits get together, what it means. Like I said, I am no conspiracy theorist, but two Americans and three Brits. Is that a setup again to tarnish the reputation of the Cayman Islands, to try to get out there to, and you would probably, if someone had really, really fallen prey to it, we would have seen videos and everything else. I'm sure that they probably had video cameras somewhere, you know, with them and everything else. Of course, you won't see that now because the bankers rejected them. But I see this again as another conspiracy. Gentlemen, what do you think about it?
I would suggest that I'm assuming those authorities who had them within questioning should have their document details in respect to who they were, if in fact those documents were real.
Right. You know what happened in Israel with the false British passports.
Exactly. But I would try my best to do as an authority here locally, because we know that these things have happened in the past, and we know that our financial industry has been under immense pressure from outside industries. I would, as a representative, ask my local authorities to try to investigate or do some research on the names to find out if we can link them back to any sort of authority elsewhere. Mm-hmm. And if it doesn't come up that way, then at least we just know it's just five criminals who were trying to do something wrong. But I'd rather have that ticked off the list, because if in fact a theory like that actually was happening, we have to take a serious approach to this, because we know other jurisdictions. We're talking about billions of dollars worth of an industry that we have here. And people are willing to do whatever it takes to try to destroy that. And we have to acknowledge there's other people out there who are going to do everything and anything. A lot of people call McKeever a conspiracy theorist with all the things he said, that they're coming after our industry. But we can now see that the current representatives are feeling a lot of those pressures that he were talking about. Mm-hmm. And a lot of the reports and a lot of the leaders in other jurisdictions, still, even after McKeever is gone, is still putting that pressure on. So it's not like it's not real. Mm-hmm. So we should be aware of it and at least try to do everything we can as the representatives to make sure that we don't allow that to happen.
Chris, you're in the financial services industry. What does this look like to you? I mean, in this day and age, do we really have stupid Americans and Brits coming down here to go to a bank and say we want to talk about, you know, doing foreign exchange transactions and, you know, $500,000?
$500 million.
And just to say that Kenneth's point is valid, that the government should not just leave this alone. What if the police, after checking their background, that they say to them, listen, we were only here to do a check to see whether or not this would really happen, and this is who we really are. Shouldn't the people of the Cayman Islands, exactly, at least the government, know that when someone comes here and tries to infiltrate our system?
Hussein, I want to say something that a lot of people are going to dislike, but it's Friday and I'm being me. A lot of people really do not understand the beast that we have in terms of the financial industry. One of the things that, I mean, we've heard all the while, harmful tax competition and tax haven and the whole nine yards. In the next 17 months, thereabouts, Obama will be gone as President of the United States, and Euclid House will still be right there. Gordon Brown, Tony Blair, you name it, the list has been long but distinguished in terms of people coming after the Cayman Islands. And we need to understand that we are not someone or a jurisdiction to be taken lightly. What we do here, we actually serve a global purpose. People need to understand the United States. The United States is 50, in essence, 50 different countries operating in one union. There is no federal registration of companies. So there's a reason why there a lot of insurance companies go to Bermuda. Because you're talking about, it's not as easy to just set up one company and then do what it is you want to do. But more importantly, what we need to understand in a globalization, in a globalized world, what globalization does is increase trade. When you have increased trade, you have increased investments. When you have increased investments, you have the need for increased capital. And it is that capital flows where the Cayman Islands really fits in. And you look at countries like Canada, for example. If you're a Canadian entity and you are making money on your overseas foreign subsidiaries, you can send that money back to Canada and not be taxed on it. So Canada, to their credit, is progressive in that standpoint. The United States is one country that has worldwide taxation. So even if you're making money outside the United States and you decide, you know what, I'm not ready to park this money yet. I want to do something else with it. If you carry that money in the States and take it back out, they're going to charge you capital gains. In other words, your capital has increased based on your investments and everything else. So what we are is a tax-neutral jurisdiction. People take that money and they place it in the Cayman Islands till they decide what they want to do with it. You carry it on shore and you do something, you make a decision, you're going to be charged tax. So you leave it in places like the Cayman Islands. And the very same people that leave these money in the Cayman Islands is the very same people that funds the United States Army elections, fund the UK elections, these special interest groups. I mean, Mitt Romney, everybody literally had money in the Cayman Islands. I mean, but yet they can get up and complain about us. This is the way it works.
Okay, one caller. Let's go to the phone lines. Caller, good morning. Welcome to For the Record.
Good morning, OC.
Good morning. How are you?
Good morning, Chair Guy. First of all, I'd like to start off by saying I'm a first-time caller to your program.
Yes, I recognize that.
I've sat here and waited almost 25 minutes.
Sorry about that.
In my car, because unfortunately, Radio Cayman isn't on live stream, and you know most of us don't really own radios anymore outside the car. But I must say that I waited patiently because you have two dynamic guests in the studio today, and I wanted to just make some comments.
And what about the host?
You know, I was waiting to make fun of you because I see Kenneth posted a picture of you on Facebook, and you look a little scared in that photo.
Oh, I probably am.
I said, man, looks like he was, I don't know if that was a
selfie. Kenneth, we're going to have to change that one and put up another one.
Yeah. He definitely caught you at a moment there, like a deer in headlights. Anyway. Good morning to all of you.
Morning.
I just wanted to say that, Kenneth, you know, I have been a real supporter of you throughout this ordeal, and I continue to support you publicly. Obviously, I use my Facebook page to convey that message as often as I can and to encourage other people to be supportive of you, because I have had the misfortune of having to deal with the judiciary on a number of occasions. I'm starting to lose count at this point in time. But I think that one thing for sure is it certainly opens your eyes to a lot of different aspects of what happens within the halls of justice, so to speak. And, you know, I was just commenting on another story this morning to say that, in fact, in my opinion, Lady Justice isn't always blind. I must say that the fact that your trial started this week and you're not able to get a continuation date until sometime in November speaks volumes to some of the administrative issues that the court system is facing. And I think that that's highly unfair to you because, you know, as an average person, you have to maintain yourself and you have to maintain your family. And this ordeal is prohibiting you from probably, you know, taking advantage of certain employment opportunities that could be present.
Justice denied.
And I think it's very, very unfortunate that is how the system works. And there seems to be little regard for how that delay impacts people in a real sense. And I can recall from, you know, my very first court incident with the allegation of the dog theft, which was so ridiculous that the judge actually threw it out and said there was no case to answer after the prosecution had put forward their case. But in order for me to get a court date within, you know, what was considered at that time an expedited amount of time, they had to pull in a special magistrate and set aside 3 days for that to happen. And there were people who were saying to me, oh, wow, Sandra, how did you get this to happen? Blah, blah, blah. Like, it was such a big deal. And I was so dumbfounded and astounded. But now, you know, 3-4 cases later, I quite understand why people were surprised by that. And I think that, you know, that issue has to be addressed. There's so many concerns with the judiciary and with how things are done. I must say, once you're actually in there, I think that for the most part, the judges do a very, very good job. And, you know, the court staff mostly work as hard as they can. But there are a lot of issues that are allowed to happen. There's a lot of really substandard behavior that is permitted when it comes to especially the DPP's office. And even some of the defense attorneys, you know, constant delays and, you know, the court just kind of gives them a slap on the wrist. Oh, you shouldn't do it. And then you go on and they keep doing it. And there's no real consequences for their actions. So I'm hoping that, Kenneth, you will be exposed to a lot more, I think, as this continues your trial in November. Ironically, I have a trial in November as well. I'm really praying that there are no delays in regards to that because, you know, that's like 9 months later waiting on that to come to fruition.
Yes.
But once you have your day in court, I feel confident that you will be vindicated if the, you know, justice that's magistrate that's hearing the matter has any degree of common sense. I think he will be able to see precisely what happened. One final note, Kenneth, when I was reading the details of, you know, what has already come out in court about the assault on the police officer, the off-duty officer that you were attempting to protect, and the subsequent assault on her by that same person, I had to wonder if her subsequent assault resulted, heaven forbid, in a more serious damage to her, say loss of life or severe physical, you know, deformities or whatever. I wonder if the DPP's office would have continued to pursue this case against you. And I'll just leave it there.
And of course, you know, he can't comment on it.
But I will say one thing, though. In the U.S., I mean, people have a right to guaranteed a right to a speedy trial. I think in New York State, I think they have like 6 months in which to bring something for all cases, except I think for maybe murder or something like that. And I think in California, like 60 days or something like that. So on a small island like this, when you have a case being dragged out. And I'm one of them personally. I strongly believe in the separation between the legislative, the executive, and the judicial. But I think the judicial needs to start doing a better job in terms of putting some kind of level of confidence within the country. Because I can tell you right now, they are not at the confidence level I believe that they should be at in terms of this country, where people can see, feel a little bit better. You had one case where I think 5 years it was dragged out and all that kind of stuff. I mean, luckily, I think that person was employed within the civil service, so to some extent, they were being able to get compensated or even AFP or something like that. I'm not sure. But if that was a private sector employee having that kind of stuff over here for 5 years, I mean, that in itself is a miscarriage of justice. At some point, we need to draw the line and say, you know what, if you can't carry this out there right now, you can't be dragging someone through the mud for so long in a small island like this where they can't basically feed their family the right way. And that is wrong.
Folks, I want to remind you that you're listening to For the Record. I am your host, Orrit Connor. My guest in the studio with me this morning, two young, budding Caymanian politicians, Mr. Christopher Saunders, Mr. Kenneth Brian. Please stay tuned. We'll be back shortly. Good morning and welcome back to For the Record. In the studio with me this morning, Mr. Kenneth Brian, Mr. Christopher Saunders. One of our loyal listeners, and this is an old email, but because I had some email issues, I was unable to access it, and then I figured I'd wait until today's show to read it. But this listener had a question concerning the Lyme office in Countryside, Bordentown. And she wanted this question aired with the hope that sometime by the end of the program or some clarity may be gained from her question. And her concern is that residents can only go to this office at the Savannah Countryside to pay a phone bill.
So if you request a statement or any other information for that matter, you are told that you have to go to West Bay Road office. Of course, she points out that this is very stressful for residents in their district, and I would imagine probably for any other district if they have to go into countryside to pay, you know, as well. So, and many of them are elderly who cannot go to West Bay Road to West Bay Road location. So she wanted to know, you know, about this. And Chris, we spoke about this off air, but I'd like you to elaborate on air for our listening audience.
Yeah, no problem. I think if my memory serves me correct, the office in countryside is actually an agent. It's not really a lime office per se, in terms of just like a regular dealer or something. Mm-hmm. So I think that may be the challenge. And in some cases, I haven't worked previously in both digital and lime. Cayman and Wireless back then. What I can see from a company standpoint, telephone records are also considered private. So from a citizen standpoint, do you want any and everyone out there having access to your phone bill? So that may be an issue within itself. I know there are a lot of ways online and so forth you can get your telephone bill. So that has always been a question in terms of a privacy from the carrier standpoint.
So you believe that this office may be a contractor?
I think it is. If my memory serves me right, it is not. I think the one in Galleria is actually manned by actual Cayman and Wireless staff. Mm-hmm. And of course, would be subject to Cayman and Wireless employee rules and everything else, But I think the other one, I think it is actually just a contractor. And in the past, I know it was always a privacy issue in the terms of, we saw it when I was at Digicel. How much access do you want people having to your systems with your customer information? So I think that may be the issue in at this time.
Okay. I'm going to go back on to the international front for a minute. And I know, Chris, I'm going to ask you to just one evening this week, we were talking, about your school days and your situation. And you'll understand what I'm talking about when I come to it. But today marks 70 years since Japan's World War II surrender. The Japanese Prime Minister Shinzo Abe has apologized for the Japanese atrocities during that period, and he really, really has apologized for that. And I say this, that in many instances we are still waiting, and when I say we, I'm talking about black people in the Caribbean and elsewhere, are still waiting for apologies from the Brits, from the rich families and the rich, the mercantile classes that benefited from the slave trade. Mm-hmm. Now, the whole discussion about reparations is still alive in the Caribbean, mm-hmm. not getting enough traction as it should get, and I don't believe that we're putting the pressures in the right place in relation to this, but we have not received proper apologies. When you think of it, look at me, look at the three of us, say, you think there's a good possibility with globalization that we may have ended up in the Cayman Islands anyway, mm-hmm. but if it weren't for slavery, we probably would not. So slavery had such a profound effect, on the world and the way that the world is configured, population-wise today. And we still have not received proper apologies from it. Now, we know that some of our African brothers and sisters think differently. And so, Chris, I'm going to ask you to relate your little school experience when you said, what's happening, brother?
No. And the thing about it is this, and I'll say this much, OC. I have made a personal decision politically to, other than learning from the past, pretty much not living it. A good friend of mine who is a retired senior politician in the Caribbean, this is something that's near and dear to him in terms of the whole repatriation type business. But I will say this much, and it's just my personal opinion. Where do you start and where do you stop? Because at the end of the day, the African countries were the ones who basically sold black people into slavery. The European merchants just basically bought them. So, in fairness, I think Ghana...
Slavery was something that was there because it was introduced mainly by the Arabs. So it was a way of life. I'm talking about the horrendous transatlantic journey over here and how we were treated.
I mean, the thing about it is, if you go back, even look at the UK, for example, the UK, I think, abolished slavery a couple of decades even before the United States. Guys like Wilberforce, who was literally able to get
William Wilberforce?
Who was able to literally get slavery abolished within the UK like nothing. I mean, the United States. I mean, say what you want to say. The issue between North and South was fought over slavery. I was in college days in New York. I remember seeing this African guy, and I'm like, you know what's up, my brother? You're not my brother. You're the descendants of slaves. I'm like, excuse me. You heard me. You're the descendants of slaves. He says, we're sick and tired in Africa of hearing you guys talking about going back to Africa. Do you know where in Africa you come from? And as a matter of fact, if we wanted you back in Africa, we would have come back for you. But we didn't want you there. That's why we got rid of you. Wow. And I'm like, okay, that's a little bit eye-opening. So I don't feel so bad now when all them people be starving and don't send no money. And I said that to him. I said, you know what? Well, and this was just young. I mean, this was a response. Well, all you can starve over there, and I'll keep my weight problem on this side. Thanks for selling me into slavery. So at least nobody ain't chopping me up for being no tribal Utu or whatever. So, but I mean, it is, but at the same time, too, Osi, I will say this much. If you look at African countries versus Europeans, Scandinavians, and even the Asians, for example, one of the big difference, and this is not anything for us to blame
real
on anybody.
Quickly, because we got four callers.
But we need to invest more in our people. If you look at them African countries, the failure to invest in their people is one of the things that we have brought from within the Caribbean mindset, where we have not done the same too. And we have literally perpetuated this cycle of having our people just institutionalized poverty across the place. So, and we can take the callers.
Okay, let's go to the phone lines. Caller, good morning. Welcome to For the Record.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Hello.
Yeah, go right ahead. We're hearing you.
Yes, good morning. Good to have all three of you on this morning. It's a brilliant discussion going on.
Thank you.
And Chris, you had to make me laugh. But you know, it's humorous, but it's true. And I think we really need to have a very intellectually honest discussion about those things, looking into Cayman's history and stuff like that. But I can't claim to be a good historian, but I really enjoy understanding history the best I can. And one of these days, need to talk about that. I have something else I want to talk about this morning.
Sure.
And Chris, by the way, you know, this is Tim Adam, right? We both But you said something just now that I'm not so sure it's true, you know.
Which one?
Did you ever work for Lime?
No, it's Cable and Wireless. It's about then it was Cable and Wireless. I did correct myself.
No, because I can't honestly say I ever worked for Lime.
No. But, you know, what is ironic, Tim, and I'm glad you mentioned it, is that what it is that we wanted to build in Cayman and Wireless and what we were suggesting to them that needs to be done is pretty much what it is that they're doing now. And if they had listened to us from back then, that company would have been so much further ahead. So I just need to get that off my chest.
Yeah, Chris, you know, what can I say about amen? I mean, but anyhow, that's a whole other day's discussion. Mm-hmm. No, gentlemen, what I wanted to chime in on, and I've been waiting a little while, and I'm sorry I'm taking you back an early part of your conversation.
No
but
problem.
You were talking about the issues, the matters of crime, the matters of employment, mm-hmm. and so on. And I'm not a sociologist, but it seems to me like there is a pretty close correlation between when people have useful occupation and when they don't. And
I agree
with
you.
It seems to me, right, without really having studied it, and I know it's dangerous to do such a thing, like there is some correlation when you don't have something to do. The old saying that the idle hands are the devil's workshop is very much, very much in play here. I'm sorry, somebody's trying to call me, so it may interrupt the flow of the voice. But anyhow, I wanted to let you know some data that I found out looking at this cruise berthing facilitation. Mm-hmm. And it really pertains very closely to what the matter of the discussion is. You know, there's a lot of discussion going on about the environmental aspects of this. There's not as much and not as much as needs to be going on about the environmental. And there's been good studies done on that, on the economic. There's been good studies done on the economic part of it. PricewaterhouseCoopers were the ones contracted. They produced an outline business case. If you haven't read it, I encourage you to read it. I think it's maybe 60 pages long. It's very readable.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the things that I've highlighted is that the full-time equivalent number of employees that this project can generate over its lifetime is something like 999 full-time employees, right? That's in their most conservative case. That's their base case. In the upside case, if you extrapolate the figures, right, the number comes up to a huge amount, over 4,000. No, that's not something for us to sneeze at or just easily dismiss, right?
The fact
of this employment, the fact of how it impacts on jobs, real jobs, you know? I mean, this is a real-life situation. I remember, why these statistics go to my heart. I remember working closely with PwC, our board, my president's lawyer. They very wisely said, you know, let's take a look at the economic impact of Cayman Turtle Farm. It helps us make wise decisions as to how we plan and how we apply finances and so on. And I'm just trying to remember off the top of my head really quickly some numbers, but my recollection is that, and PwC were the ones contracted to do it. By the way, when we talk about PricewaterhouseCoopers, you're talking about the world's second largest firm of its type of consultancy in the world, you know.
Yeah. Tim, I'm going to ask if you can give us a short version of it, please.
So in that study, they showed the economic difference, right, of between what pertains today without cruise berthing and what would obtain if it was cruise berthing, jumped from in Cayman Turtle Farm case, just one company alone, jumped from about 203 full-time employees to over 600. But when you look at the data in the outline business case, it jumped. It's 999 in the base case, and the figure ends up at more than 4,000 in the upside business case. What I'm saying is, guys, we need to have a discussion. What is it that's preventing us from moving ahead with this thing?
Because exactly, yeah. We have to get away from the emotional discussion and get down to real brass tacks, you know, in relation to it as well. But Tim, I'm going to ask you if you can leave us there, because we know we kept you waiting for a long time, but several other calls online. So we're going to ask you to leave us there. Folks, I want to remind you, you're listening to For the Record. I'm your host, Art Connor. My guest in the studio with me this morning, Mr. Christopher Saunders and Mr. Kenneth Bryan. When we come back, we're going to go back straight to the phone lines and accommodate all of those callers who've been waiting. Please stay tuned. We'll be back shortly. Good morning and welcome back to For the Record, where we're going straight to the phone lines. Caller, good morning. Welcome to For the Record.
Yeah, good morning, Mr.
Morning, Amjet. How are you?
Good morning, Kenneth. Good morning, Mr. Chris.
Morning, bro.
Good morning.
First, I just called to offer my full support to my brother Kenneth, and I wish him the best in his trial. I believe you're an innocent man, and we all believe you're a good guy in this society, and we hope and wish you the best in your trial.
Thank you very much, Amjad. Thank you. I appreciate it.
And we offer our full support, you know, and prayers for you.
Thank you.
Really, I just want to say something to the editor general before I say what I want to say.
Okay, you got to do it real fast if you're going to get two of them in.
Yes, it just, we hate, you know, too much long goodbyes to the editor general. I was hoped that he buy one-way ticket and, you know, in his way to Paris, and don't come back, because really he was the worse than the one before. You know, they both of them worse than each other. What I want to ask Mr. Chris today is, there's an announcement about a group you was part of it. Can you please confirm some of the names? You know, are they truly, because there's some speculation in here and there that some people deny, or some people, you know, I see Mike Adam name, I see other people name. So we want you to explain about that, please, and let us know who is members. And, you know, the good thing about this group that we, the UDP, you know, as a party, we graduate some politicians. It's gone to PNA, and now we graduating some politicians to go to a new party. So we are a great party. You know, I think the UDP always produce more politicians to this country, and that's a school of politics. The UDP is a school of politics, and I think this is positive. You know, when we see some people, you know, going to form a new group and run for election and coming out of UDP, yeah, that's something good and positive.
Okay, let's have Chris answer that briefly before we go to our other callers. Chris?
Well, first of all, you're not going to get that answer because some of the people that we are speaking to still have other commitments. Some I can probably say that are interested are even civil servants. Some are actually people in the PPM. Some are people in the UDP. And some are actually people within the C4C. Yeah, no, I'm putting it out there. And the reason being, people need to remember what's the purpose of a political party. It's a group of people that shares like-minded values, like-minded views. And one of the things, I mean, look at Kenneth. And Kenneth is sitting here. Kenneth is a good friend of mine. No, at least I consider him a good friend of mine. In the last election, we were in separate teams. Now, throughout the entire time, Kenneth is very passionate about some of the things I'm passionate about in terms of cost of living, mortgages, I mean, family value issues and so forth. And those are the kind of things where we as a group, because one thing, Amjad, and I'll say this much, I consider everybody in the UDP still my friend, even if they may think otherwise. I consider there are many people in the PPM, I will say this much, regardless of where we stand politically, I'm not going to sit back and say anything bad about any one of them. We're all patriots. We all love our country. What we disagree on is what we want our country to look like and what we want our country to go. That is really where the disagreement is. What I can say to you about this new group, and for every single one that I've spoken to, the conversation has been the same. Please tell me your vision for the Cayman Islands and what does success look like. Because that's one of the things that we have not cleared on as a people. Where do we want this country to go and how do we measure success? And we need to make sure, regardless of how it ends up or how it finishes, is that every single one of us are on the same page in terms of what we want the Cayman Islands to look like. So this is pretty much where we are. Unfortunately, in politics and in life, if you do something long enough, you will develop dislikes, you will develop enemies, and the Cayman society has become too diverse and too dynamic to basically be looking in a very narrow window. In terms of, well, this is what it was back in the 60s, this is what it was back in the 70s. No, we are where we are now. And the question is, how do we move from where we are and how do we move forward? And that is what it is that we are focusing on.
Okay. Let's go to the next caller. Caller, good morning. Welcome to For the Record.
Yeah, good morning, O.C. Good morning.
Morning, Rupert. How are you?
Brian.
Good morning, Mr. Roops.
Yeah, I have, I was thinking about something the other day. Maybe you can confirm this. Is it $1.7 billion that we're in debt that are...
No. I think there's a difference between what we actually owe and the liabilities that we generate.
Right.
And I think
the liabilities,
the unfunded liabilities.
Which includes those of statutory authorities and government companies.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, so what I was saying, I did a little exercise last time. You guys can do it and tell me what you come up with, but I came up with something like, if you got 60,000 people on this island, it works out to be about $20-something million for each and every person. Check it out. I don't know if that might...
No. In fairness, Mr. Roops, I mean, if you take liability, for example, your liability can be almost unlimited. I mean, I can say to you right now that you have a $3 million liability. The minute you probably have a health issue or something. So it is always the kind of the unknown to some extent. What I can say to us as a people is that the bigger liability that I am worried about is the one where people in this country can't afford to save for their retirement, and that is a bigger liability in terms of coming down the road. So you already have a portion of government liabilities unfunded, but that is the government itself. But when you look at the people and where the people is going as a country, is that how do we get people to save for their retirement? Because as it stands right now, moving to retirement age of 65 just confirms that people can't afford to retire at 60. And if we think they can't retire at 60, why do we think they can retire at 65? So rather than try to shift the problem 5 years down the road, the question is, how do we address it now? What do we put in place to ensure that our people can retire? Simple programs such as a reverse mortgage, we have seen many of it in the United States advertised, that allow elderly folks in the golden years to stay within their home and literally transfer down a mortgage to another generation. What Steve said, I think it was last week, is that we need to look and ask ourselves the question, do we really have a mortgage in this country or do we have demand loans? When you take a standard 25-year mortgage times 12, that's 300 payments. You can't have a situation where you pay religiously for 195, 196 times, but the minute you miss the next three or four payments, you're out of a house. I mean, what do we have in place to protect people for that? You could have paid 220 times. All of a sudden, you miss three or four. Bam, you're going on the verge of losing your house. I mean, come on. We as a people need to do better than that.
Okay, one more call.
What I'm going to say was this, that exactly what I'm talking about. We need in Cayman, we need consumer protection in some form.
Absolutely,
yep.
Because what I see going on here with the banks and every place else and the oil companies and everybody else, it don't seem like nobody's really, you know, that adamant about doing it. But it needs to be done because poor people are the ones that suffer.
Yeah, we got to keep calling for that. Thank you very much, caller, for that. Let's see if we can grab the other caller before we go to our headline news. Caller, good morning. Welcome to For the Record. Good morning, caller. Welcome to For the Record.
Good morning.
Good morning. How are you?
Yes, Mr. Saunders.
Morning, my brother. And good to hear you back. I understand you weren't feeling well a few weeks back. So it's glad to have you back on the radio.
No, I've been feeling well all the time.
Well, that's good.
I'm a healthy individual. Thank God for that.
Okay, go right ahead, caller.
Mr. Saunders.
Yes, sir.
Thank God for wisdom, knowledge, and understanding. And I've been identifying individuals very carefully
. Caller, you're coming in a little bit delayed there. Do you have your radio on in the background?
You can hear me now?
I'm hearing you, but you're coming in delayed, which tells us that you're listening to something in the background. You're not flowing through.
Yeah, can you hear me now?
Yep.
Okay. I've been identifying individuals who are offering themselves as candidates to become members of the Legislative Assembly. Mm-hmm. And I have to say, Mr. Saunders, you are a very strong individual in the UDP. And now you all have started another party now. Which means you all aren't into this one man, one vote, it seems like. As people said, doing the same things, expecting different results. So you all are actually saying now, the PPM was no good, the UDP wasn't no good, vote for us, and we gonna make the difference. But I thank God that I'm an individual who is blessed wisely from above. And I use my wisdom very wisely. That people aren't able to tell me who I should vote for. And what is right and what is wrong. And what is the best decision to make when it comes to the future.
Thank you, caller. Very quickly, because we got to go to the news break. We passed it now.
Yes, the one man, one vote is the change for this country. And you all should not be encouraging another party so you all can have a big party again and ruin this country worse than what it was.
Thank you very much, caller. Let's go to headline news. Chris, you got a lot on your plate when you come back. Please stay tuned. We'll be back shortly after the headline news. Good morning and welcome back to For the Record, where I have in the studio with me this morning Mr. Christopher Saunders, Mr. Kenneth Bryan. Christopher.
Yes. No.
You have several things. I know you want to respond to Timmy in relation, to the port issue, as well. So give you the floor for a while, or the mic, I should say.
Okay, no problem. First of all, just respond to the last caller. No party is being formed. Nothing wrong if a group of concerned citizens worried about the direction of their country decides to come together to see what's the best way we can move a country forward. As to jumping as far as the one man, one vote, what I've said already publicly, I have no problem stating again. I am supportive of one man, one vote, but my only issue with it is, and I've said it before, is that major decisions such as these must be made by the people of the Cayman Islands. It can't be made by politicians. I think we'd be going down a wrong road if we start opening up major decisions such as these to politicians for the simple fact we know the Premier's party's position. We know what the UDP position is. If the PPM goes in right now and makes a change, what's to stop a future UDP government from going back in to change it back? The question is, as a people and as a democracy, do we want to start opening this door where we start having major decisions such as these made by politicians? We as voters need to realize that the highest political office we have in this country is that of voter. And major decision must go back to the people. That is my take on that. So in terms of that, that is clear. So, and as I said before, I'm not even sure I'm even running, because at the end of the day, if I don't see where we can put together a solid team in which to make a difference, I'm not even going to go through this entire process. I have no intention of sitting on any backbench and basically moan, complain, or whatever. I can do that already. I don't need the people that came and asked to be paying me to complain, straight up. So I can do that for free. In terms of what Mr. Adam had raised in terms of the Cruz Burton position, at this point, as it stands, I am opposed to it, and I've said so publicly. And I'm opposed to it for economic purposes. There is a story, I think it was this Milton Friedman went to China, and I think they were building a dam. And when he got there, he noticed that a lot of the work guys were actually using shovels and pickaxes and so forth. So he asked the question, why don't you have the heavy equipment and doing all of this and getting all of that done? He said, but if we did that, they told him that if we did that, then we wouldn't have created as much jobs. So his response was simple. Are you trying to build a dam, or are you trying to create jobs? Well, it's the same thing with the port. I mean, do we need a port or we don't need a port? Yes, there may be other benefits from it, but we need to stay in terms of focus on what needs to be done. From an economic standpoint, and this is going by the government's recent annual economic report for 2014, and just bear with me because I'm just going from memory right here. Between 2012 and 2014, cruise passengers actually increased by 100,000 in terms of cruise arrival. And the revenue to government increased by actually 600,000. Now, bearing in mind that the port fee is actually $1,750 US, that is shared between the government, the port authority, and the tenders. But the government portion of whatever the cruise fee was increased by 600,000. Went on roughly 100,000 increase in cruise tourism. On the air arrival side, 60,000 people increased between 2012 and 2014, and government room accommodation tax increased by 6.5 million. So here you have 100,000 cruise tourism putting 600,000 in additional revenues to government, and here you have 60,000 air arrivals giving 6.5 million increase to government coffers. So you can do the maths. Secondly, when you start looking at one of the logic that people keep talking about, oh, these big ships being built and that big ship being built. Well, big planes are being built every day. Yet I don't hear anyone talking about extending the runway to start getting into bigger aircrafts so they can basically take off in Cayman fully loaded and not have to be stopping the Bahamas. We need to be getting more European tourists inside here. We need to start getting more Asian tourists.
But we are upgrading our airport. But I must say, if you think that cruise tourism isn't important, you'll find it out when you don't have it.
No. Listen, Ose, I'm going to tell you right now. But this goes back to the bigger question. I mean, the numbers that they're talking around in the hundreds of millions is not a small spend. And the one thing I ask anybody straight up, what is the complete plan for tourism? The last tourism plan we had was done when Chucky was tourism minister. That was the last time. What does the tourism future looks like? At the end of the day, and this is, I'm waiting for the update, the Brea report, but the last one that came out, referring to 2012, showed that $2 billion is what was spent in the Caribbean on cruise tourism. $2 billion. Total between passengers and crew members, $2 billion. Of that, five islands account for 72%. And my question remains, if we go and we invest this hundreds of millions of dollars, is the $2 billion pie going to grow? Chances are, no. Secondly,
we have to look way, way down the line. We have to look beyond my generation and your generation. Exactly. We have been too myopic in the Cayman Islands in terms of our planning process rather than looking way down.
Let me finish my thought process. Okay. Of that $2 billion, five islands account for 72%. And the Cayman was number five, Puerto Rico's number four, Bahamas was number one. I forgot what two and three was. My issue is this now, and I went to the report that those guys had published in terms of their numbers and their ranges and all that kind of stuff. My issue is this, with Cuba now opening up, and you're ready to see Carnival and all of them now vying to get into Cuba, the question is, what do we expect that pie to grow by? What is it that we're looking at? And the question is, we still have, 1.7 million passengers coming through this year. One of the best years that we had was 1.7 million. Granted that Mexico had around two or three hurricanes when we had that. The question is, you go back to a matter of priority. You can't sit down and be spending this kind of money, yet you got schools unfinished. You don't know what the full plan for tourism is. You just can't be throwing money at problems without a plan. And that is my issue. What is the full plan for tourism?
We can't afford to be left behind. We have one caller online. Caller, good morning. Welcome to For the Record.
Good morning, OC, and good morning to the panelists there.
Good morning, Mr. Bush.
How are you? Mr. Bush.
On my show this morning.
We talked about that yesterday evening.
there's a lot of good subjects there. I just want to say the one thing. That the tourism plan was put in place when I was in the ministry, and it was updated, and it was supposed to be updated up until 2013, I believe. Maybe I'm a couple of years shy, but certainly it was certainly what we had to work with when I was there last 2009, and I picked it up again and until 2012. But it was current. It was current. I put it in place. I commissioned it, I put it in place, and it was updated until, I think, 2013. So it was current. And the plan, several things, of course, not everything gets done in a plan all the time. That's why you have to update it, review it, and update it. But certainly, the stayover visitors, tourists, and the cruise visitors were brought up to par from what we wanted in the plan, or to what we wanted in the plan. So we followed the plan. The ideal was to get, of course, more and more visitors, overnight visitors, and, of course, to bring up the crews up to a level that we could manage. And we can manage the level we got now, and people think it's stressed out. I listened to Mr. Adams a while ago, and what I want to say is, it's a pity those persons that didn't come out and support the deal. We hadn't got to the point where we decided exactly where we go. We were back and forward with it, of course, looking at how to make the plan better. We had our concerns about the reef. The economic concerns we had come to the point where we knew that we had to have enough cruise visitors to allow the port to keep some money and allow the port, of course, to the cruise, the docks, to pay for itself. So you had to bring in enough so that government and the port would still get some money, and the cruise, of course, the dock pay for itself. But all of that was ongoing when they started talking about process rather than getting the dock. And so today, now we're stuck back in the argument again and going back up. All the same argument, whether it's economical or viable and whether we need it or don't. I have my concerns about locating, how it's located, and what we do move, because we do must be concerned about the underwater reef there. We have to be concerned because Georgetown. But as soon as we get to a point, all this comes back up and the whole debate goes over and over. Cruise is vital. Airport is vital. Airport is going on, but they have decided, taken an arbitrary, as far as I'm concerned, position not to extend the runway, and that is foolish.
I agree with you. There's
many things that's foolish about that plan, but that one is absolutely foolish, and Chris is right about that one. But also, nobody must discount the value of cruise tourism, because I kept saying years ago from 2002, when I started to push hard for cruise tourism, I'm going to cut it short, O.C. When I started,
it's your show.
And the then government, who's now the same government now, and the Hansard was berating me for increasing cruise tourism. I said I was going to increase it, and we pushed to it to the Caribbean, because at that time the Caribbean was sort of anti all these cruise, most islands. Well, they had some, they were anti, and then when cruise it dropped, they recognized the value, and there is a value in it. You know why? Because all the small operators in Cayman, Caymanians, who own small businesses, who do the tours, who have the taxes, that is where the value comes into the country. And there is a lot of them. If we had built a dock, we'd have been 1,000 people employed, and probably another 1,500 would have been if we had done to the farm, fixed spots, because spots definitely need to be fixed, and done whatever we could do out in Georgetown without the serious environmental damage that is being talked about at this present time. But where to put the dock? We all know where the dock should be. It's either South Sound or the North Sound, and nobody wants to touch either one. So where is the dock going to go? We cannot discount cruise tourism.
Nope.
No.
And we can't be left behind in the game. We cannot be left behind in the game. And what we have now is not sufficient as far as berthing is concerned.
Well, you know, when I put that up, this too, the present government fought me on that too. But that is the political ends that is not right. Fighting it just to, because they can oppose you and make you look bad and call you crook and say, "Well, you fabricated documents to make themselves look good." You see, too much of that is going on and has gone on. That's why I took my position as a leader of opposition. I am not going to fight the things that the government needs to do for this country, and nobody can say that I have not kept my word to that since I took over as leader of opposition. That's what we need to do. Stop the infighting and get the things done for the people of this country. Not because I do that the PPM do it, that I got to fight the PPM and the PPM fight me. And that has been my story. And that's what I've kept to. Check the Hansard, the records are there. If people want to say I'm talking in the wind, check the Hansard and they will know what I am saying are the facts.
Thank you, Mr. And
one more question I have, though. Someone asked Mr. Brian about his case.
Mm-hmm.
And I want to find out from him whether it's a fact that the premier took his statement on his computer and sent it.
He can't comment on that yet because the case is still ongoing.
Don't tell me that. He can comment. He can say that's what happened. That's not saying anything about the case.
Well, I'll leave it to him to make that decision.
Sure. Okay. Thank you.
I'll leave it to him to make that decision. Anyway, as long as we don't have to take liability for it here.
No. That's not giving away anything. Okay.
So what was the question again? Because I interrupted you while you were making it.
Whether his statement was sent from his office to the commissioner of police by somebody else.
Okay, we'll get him to answer that, and we certainly look forward to seeing you next week, Friday, when we start. We want to talk about the Nation Building Fund and, you know, all of the publicity in relation to that, Mr. Bush. We want to thank you very much. We'll get Kenneth to answer your call, but we've got to go to a quick commercial break now. Folks, I want to remind you, you're listening to For the Record. I'm your host, Dorrit Connor. My guest with me this morning, Mr. Christopher Saunders, Mr. Kenneth Bryan. Please stay tuned. We'll be back shortly. Good morning and welcome back to For the Record. I'm your host, Dorrit Connor. My guest in the studio with me this morning, Mr. Kenneth Bryan, Mr. Christopher Saunders. Very quickly, before we go back to the phone lines, Kenneth, I think you want to respond to the Leader of the Opposition's question, or whether or not you want to respond to it.
Well, I'll just say this much. There was evidence so far that was given to the court that there is an email that was sent from the Premier's office to the Police Commissioner's office in relation to my matter. I'm also aware of it. I can't say much more about it because it's going to be a bit of a subject to my case, and I'll just leave it there. But I too have concerns, but I don't want to let the cat out of the bag, so to speak, before we go any further.
Okay, thank you very much. Let's go to the phone lines. Caller, good morning. Welcome to For the Record. Good morning, caller. Welcome to For the Record. No one there? No one here. Okay. 10 minutes left to go. I have a couple of emails.
I have a point.
Go ahead, Kenneth. Go.
There is one area that I think that the public needs to be aware of, and I think that I would like them to show their support for Mr. Ezard Miller. Mr. Miller is taking up a championing fight that I fully support him on in respect to. There is a proposal right now to try to join the three major agencies, policing agencies, the Attorney General's office, not Attorney General, Auditor General.
Corruption.
The Auditor General's office. The
Information Commission. And the Complaints Commission.
Yeah. And I totally oppose that idea because they become inefficient in respect to being able to police the various agencies locally. And those three agencies, among others, are the primary agencies that keep out corruption in our country. And the corruption, if it leaks back in again, like what was being said before, can damage us, our country, economically, majorly. The business society here cannot afford to have that reputation floating around again. And I think from the cost savings perspective that is being proposed about about them being merged together isn't worth the risk for a couple hundred thousand dollars worth of savings that they're claiming, and that's the reason for it. It's just not worth the risk. I'd rather have them as separate entities so they can do the job properly, to keep an eye on all of those persons who were misusing their offices or doing wrong things. And I support Mr. Miller in respect to him standing for that. And I want all those who have any idea about it or are not familiar with it, try to pay close attention and respect to that and give Mr. Miller
because
your support.
It's important to weigh the pros and cons of that. Yeah. Christopher, and I know that we were asking you about a subject that you basically, or an issue that, you know, you pretty far removed from. So the listener wasn't satisfied with your response about the countryside thing. She kept saying that you kept thinking, I think, but you only can say if you think.
Well, to be honest, I know for a fact, but I'll leave myself. It is because I had the same problem too. I did ask the question, and that is what I was told. Yeah. But, you know, that was several months back. It could have changed then, so my information isn't current, but that's what I was told.
And what I'll say to that listener also is that, yes, we here will try. Like I said, this email was from the 3rd of August. You know, I'm just getting to it now because of my email issues that I had. But a simple call to that office to say, why is it I can't get, you know, details of my bill here, would answer the question as well. But we will do that also. You know, I will take that. As a matter of fact, I went there this week. I hadn't seen the email yet. I went there to pay my bill this week, and I could have asked the question. But I will do that for the caller.
But since I mentioned it, someone did send me a WhatsApp confirming that and I'll tell you exactly what it was they said. You're correct, Reese, in Dublin Countryside. It is a privately owned business who acts as an agent.
Right.
So okay. That was a message that came in out. But like I said, my information was several months back, and I didn't want to, you know, it wasn't current, but someone had since messaged me and confirmed that.
So I hope the, you know, our listener has been able to hear that. Now, that listener also wanted to know and says that the Cumber Avenue residents are still waiting to hear something regarding the promise that was discussed with yourself and Mr. A. Thompson concerning the flooding issue. They still wanting to hear anything on that, the flooding
actually issue. I've actually been back and forth talking to Eddie. Eddie has been on vacation, and prior to Eddie going on vacation, I took some time off with the wife for my own anniversary. What I can say is that he did obtain the maps. He went to Lands and Survey. He got the requisite maps that were needed. And there was two individuals that he had to meet with in terms of getting a commitment from them. I know he has been chasing one of them in particular, but he's back on the island. I think he's actually flying back out next week, and I'm actually scheduled to meet with him tomorrow to get an update also, because that is one person that I respect and admire that person, and what she can rest assured is that the last thing I ever want to do is be on her wrong side. So it is something that we are working on, but unfortunately, when you do have to deal with other players and not everything is in your control, some of these delays will happen.
Okay,
but it's something that we want to work on.
Okay, and tell us about the last tourism plan. I think
the last one was published in 2009, and I think it covered the year. Well, I'm sorry, let me rephrase that. Published on the Department of Tourism website, that's what was going on, in terms of, and it covered the period 2009 to 2013, in terms of putting together like a tourism development plan.
Mm-hmm.
Let me be clear, and I'll say this much. The two pillars of our economy right now is financial services and tourism. Cruise tourism has a role to play. It has a place to play in tourism. There's no ifs, ands, and buts about that. What also, for me, that has a plan to play, or should be playing, is when you're going to be spending hundreds of millions of dollars, we also need to set out what are the priorities for this country. Yesterday morning, I had to drop my son off to this, I think Rotary had a program for like some young leadership type thing, and I think it's part of maybe junior achievement or something, and I had to pass the unfinished schools. And OC, I'm going to tell you right now, I'm looking at the schools, looking at how it's growing up, and I'm saying to myself, and this is the same thing we talked about earlier in terms of the old slavery mentality, where we refuse to invest in our people. You have schools unfinished, we're supposed to be technically a first world country. We are classified first world by the United Nations as being a dependency of Britain. We automatically get their rating. I'm looking at those schools. Yet for the last 2 years, I hear bragging of over $200 million worth of surplus and have schools unfinished. Where is the investment in our people? And what really makes me lose the OC, and people may be vexed at me to saying this, is that we have not invested in our people. And to add insult to injury, we have made it easier for people to come from countries where those investments take place to compete against our own people. Yet we get up, we tell Caymanians, blame foreigners for this, blame foreigners for that, when in fact it is we, and I'm going to put myself in it, we who have failed our people in terms of putting that requisite investment that is needed. We have literally sold our people down the river to get a few extra dollars from work permit revenue and everything else, and basically have nothing to show for it. And I'm going to tell them right now, I have three kids. I know where I'm coming from. And this is not about income inequality or none of that kind of stuff where people talk about. Because the Cayman Islands wasn't built on that. What we were built on was income mobility. That me who can start out as a little black boy from Webb Road off North Sound Street to where I am today, came from the 88-92 government deciding to invest in me. The people that came and asked decided to give me money for a scholarship to go off and invest in my education, and then have opportunities basically for me when I came back. We have literally taken that away from our kids, and we should be ashamed of ourselves for it. The same opportunities that were given to me and many from my generations and before, we have a responsibility to pass it on to future generations, and we are failing them.
For those of our listening audience who have an interest in this, there is a document called A New Focus for Cayman Islands Tourism.
And it is a revised National Tourism Management Plan, 2009 to 2013. It was prepared by The Tourism Company. That company is located at 5 Market Yard Mews, 194 Bermondsey Street in London, in the UK. And it has some interesting topics in there, reviewing the tourism scene, visitors to the Cayman Islands, the destination, tourism products and services, challenges and opportunities. That is should be interesting because that's what we really have to look at, and a strategy for the future of tourism in the Cayman Islands. So those are some of the subtopics that are discussed in that document. So for those of you who are interested in reading that, you can go to that if you Google Cayman Islands Tourism Development Plan.
I actually have a copy of it downloaded on my phone too. So, I mean, I read it. It's about 101 pages, if my memory serves me right, but it is a real interesting document to take a look at.
Okay. And Chris, your previous comments before that, we're going to take that as your wrap-up comments.
No, there's one thing and, I wanted to... there's one thing
real
I wanted,
quickly, though, because...
Yeah. Aesop, Scott, congrats. And Adrian McKay, congrats also in terms of their future and the actuarial business. Well done to them.
Okay. And Kenneth, we're going to let you wrap up by let's have a quick bird's-eye view of one person, one vote in the Cayman Islands. I saw you yesterday evening. You had your maps of a particular constituencies. So let's give our listeners a little taste of your views on one vote.
I am prepared to move forward with one man, one vote. There is a large percentage of people in this country who believe the pros of it outweighs the cons, and there are some people who believe the cons outweigh the pros. I, as I said before, I don't think it's my place to really push the issue because I'm biased in my view. I think I'm going to do better with single member constituency, so I don't think I should force it on persons because I may be just doing it for my own benefit. Either way it comes forward, it's the way we elect our government. What's important is who you elect for your government is important to me. And I just hope that the persons and our voters stay close attention to your leadership for the future, because we have a lot of issues that are facing us and a lot of them that are not being addressed by the current representatives that we have. Some that are going to be, some could be very damaging for our grandchildren. So, I want the voters out there, and also I want to say a great thanks to many of the public members out there who have been showing their support for me throughout my unfortunate ordeal that I'm dealing with right now. I'm so happy. I can feel your prayers coming in. They keep me strong. They keep me focused on what I need to do. And though I may not say it every minute, trust me, without your blessings, without your support, I don't think I'd be as strong as I am today. So, and also remember that I will continue to do what is appropriate in respect to being your leader. So I'll say that in my closing. Thank you for the opportunity to also be here on the show with a great man like Mr. Saunders and yourself, Mr. Connor.
Well, I want to thank both of you, for being here, and in particular, Kenneth, you on short notice, as well. But we know, if you weren't here, Chris would have been able to to make up all of the time. But it's good to have him as well, folks. I want to remind you that you've been listening to For the Record. I have been your host, Art Connor, and my two guests with me this morning, two young budding politicians in the Cayman Islands, Mr. Christopher Saunders and Mr. Kenneth Bryan. I want to remind you that we are our brothers and our sisters keepers. There is always someone out there who is less fortunate than we are, and I ask you to extend a helping hand to them. If you can't do that, then you should donate to a worthy charity. We should always consider those who need, not necessarily those who want. And there are many needy in our society right here in the Cayman Islands. Sometimes we hear about them, sometimes we don't. But if you do know of someone who's needy and you can extend a helping hand, I urge you to please do so. I want to thank Digicel Top Up for being our sponsors this morning. And of course, you can send minutes to your loved ones in Jamaica from a Digicel retail location or top up kiosk, and they will receive double credits plus 7 free days of data when you send $20 or more. So you don't want to turn that deal down. I want to encourage you to continue to listen to Radio Cayman. You can join talk today at 12 noon. I believe Mr. Peter Milburn is still hosting for Sterling Dwayne Ebanks. Continue to listen to Radio Cayman for his beautiful music and all of the nice programming that goes on. I am unable to tell you who will be on Government for Government on Monday, but I'm sure that I will receive that information soon. And as usual, For the Record will be interesting and exciting no matter who is on the air here. And again, we want to thank you for being our loyal listeners and contributors to For the Record. For the Record is a success when you make it a success. I say to you, have a great weekend, stay safe, and God bless.
Informative, impartial, insightful.
This is your talk show.
1-800-534-8255. Your calls, your input. This is For the Record.